Thank you very much for everybody who's tuned in to watch, and a big welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour Winter Preliminaries for the Americas region. My name is Frodan, and I'm joined by Kevin, who's been a new caster joining us. Are you having a lot of fun, man? It seems like you're enjoying yourself up there.
I'm having a great time, and it's been a real pleasure to work with you and Brian and all the people who have done such a phenomenal job in the past. It's nice to stand among the giants.
Yeah, I mean, for now, right now, we're not giants, man. We're just like you. Basically, we're a bunch of people who love playing games and love talking about it, specifically Hearthstone, right? That's kind of the big thing. Can I just talk and get to know you a little bit more as well? We do a quick little segment. So you said that you're a journalist and you're a person who does a lot of analyst stuff, but what's your background in the entire thing? Like, how'd you really get involved in Hearthstone in the first place?
I mean, Hearthstone for me has been kind of a fun story because when I started, when Hearthstone first came out, I was kind of like lukewarm on the notion, but then as soon as it was available, I was right in there trying to play and awful, truly awful at the game, but really learned to enjoy it, learned to love it. And as time went on, I got more and more invested in esports, started with StarCraft, moved into Hearthstone, and just got tons of cool opportunities because this game is so popular and there's so much going on. I've gotten to work with a ton of really great organizations, work on some really cool articles and projects. Got to be at PAX East last year when they were announcing new sets, which was a really neat opportunity. And now continue to do coverage, and I'm up on the caster desk.
Yeah, I know. I get asked quite often. I do some of these events once in a while for Hearthstone, and people always ask me how to get involved. And I always look at people who have really worked away from the bottom, really not getting any recognition. And so there's people like you, and there's people like Cora and D2 and Sottle and Raven, all people who are very talented. Do you have any words for people who also want to get involved in Hearthstone? Maybe not necessarily as a player or not even as a caster, but just get involved in general, because you come from so many backgrounds to do things that aren't directly just playing it. What's your advice to those people?
I would say for most people, the reality is that they just need to find something about the game that they really love and put in a lot of time. When I started, I was working on free deck guides, anything I could do to just get my name out there, get my work out there. And honestly, the recognition comes. If you're good at what you do, if you care about it, if you put a lot of hard work in, I was writing for free and doing my own thing on my own time, being approached by editors from major publications saying, your stuff is really good. Would you be interested in working with us? And over time, my credibility and portfolio as a journalist grew. I was able to get involved in video production with IGN, picked up to do, obviously, the podcasts and stuff that I've been a part of over the years, and now working with Blizzard on the caster desk. And all of that as a result of just really caring a great deal, not only about Hearthstone, but about the work I was doing in the amazing scene that surrounds this game.
That's awesome. Congratulations, Kevin, again, for coming out here. You know, we're going to have a very fun rest of the day, as well as the final day tomorrow to determine who's going to be our top eight. If you wanted to ask more questions to Kevin about his journey, you can follow him on Twitter, at Lack of Realism, and just get to know him a little bit better, because I'm sure you'll see his face a lot more in the future. For now, we're done here, and our tour around the Hearthstone Championship continues with Robert Wing, Azumo, and Raven. Take it away, boys.
Thank you, Dan, and welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour America's Winter Preliminary. I am joined on the desk by two of the most handsome men in Hearthstone, TJ and Raven, and we're about to have a real barn burner on our hands, guys. That's Admirable versus Nostum. Now, before I just begin to wax eternal about my love for Nathan Zamora, TJ, what'd you tell about Nostum?
All right, Nostum, for those of you who don't know him, he actually used to stream quite a bit on Twitch, and he was known for playing wacky decks. He's sort of the wacky guy. If you know Bob Nostum, he's just super wacky. He made the Holy Wrath Paladin, which you may have seen him beat a lot of popular streamers. Basically, you put Molten Giants in your deck. You get them as low as possible by turn 5, and then you Holy Wrath them for 20 in the face. Hey, it's a 10% chance, but it works, you know, sometimes. So I'm really excited to see what he's going to be able to pull out. You guys are big Admirable fans. I know, Raven, you're a huge Admirable fan.
Yeah, I mean, one of my first actually live gigs casting was with Admirable, so that was a lot of fun to meet him in person. And yeah, he's a great guy, and he's actually been working like really hard for this event. He actually told me that he's never been more prepared for a tournament ever. He's put in so many hours, and the way he's really trying to approach it is he's just bringing solid decks that are just proven and have worked really well for him so far. So nothing, he said nothing like too fancy or too, you know, crazy, just super solid. So kind of interesting to go up against a guy like this, you know, where, as you said, he's bringing something a little bit more crazy in terms of decks.
Right, and Chalky was interviewed earlier, and Chalky and Admirable obviously go way back, and
oh, yeah.
And Kit Kats as well. We're getting very close to, thank goodness we hired Puffin, so this can't happen, but we're getting dangerously close to a Clarity Gaming reunion from ESGN TV, but Admirable takes very much after Chalky in the respect that they are here to win. They do not care what you think about their honor as players, the decks they bring. They are here to just aggro people into the ground, and it's been working obviously really well for them. And you know, obviously Admirable, one of the earliest Hearthstone casters, one of the earliest competitive level players, and I remember stumbling upon his stream just back in the day, you know, back before he was ever popular, really well known for like Tavern Takeover. Mm-hmm. You know, he was just streaming Hunter, just unleashing the hounds, just murdering people, and you know, now he's kind of a big time legend in our community, and very excited to see him get back to this point, because he tends to go back and forth between being really all in on casting and then all in on competitive play. And obviously, we are seeing fighting Admirable.
Yeah, and I cast with Admirable a lot, especially over the past couple months with Tespa and you know, a few other events here and there with the ONOG thing. So I've gotten to know him really well, and he's a super intense and super competitive guy. And he'll always be playing Hearthstone. He'll be playing Arena or Tavern Brawl, or you know, even just random mobile games that have like 200 users. He'll go online and get to the top five of the ladder and like show it off to me, and I'm like, I don't know. So he's a super fun guy to work with, just because of his intensity and his competitiveness. So looking forward to see that coming out from him.
Yeah, I definitely think it's going to be interesting, as you said, from like, we've got one player here who sounds like he's, you know, a little bit wild in terms of the deck building, and then Admirable, who's spoken to me and just said he's just taking super solid stuff. Mm-hmm. So I kind of want to see this Paladin deck you told me about, to be honest. But I feel like after the discussions we've had about decks so far this weekend, yeah. TJ, I think you're just actually just trolling me now. You're just giving me bad lists and saying, like, hey, it's a good list. It's so good in NA, and it's going to just win you all your games, and then it just fails miserably. So I think that's just one more list that you're trolling me in.
He's not going to bring now. The Holy Wrath Paladin. I just want to clarify this. But he was actually one of the first, like, 20 people to hit Legend this season, and he did it with Eggdruid. With a crazy aggressive Egg Druid. So it really shows that's in the beginning of the season when a lot of people are playing tried and true decks. So that's a cool thing. But I don't think we'll be seeing the Holy Wrath Paladin. Probably Secrets.
No, I have to expect that at this point. If you make it this far, although Yombre, Yombre breaks the rules in that respect. But if you make it this far, there's kind of this assumption that you are, in fact, playing these decks are a little more consistent and kind of offer you the results you're looking for.
Yeah.
I think in this style, though, celebrating, again, this cast that we have here, casting, that's Admirable. I think we really need to up our casting game and really make it, take it upstairs, go to the dome.
This is a huge match.
There's a lot of these that's Admirable-isms, but very excited to finally, you know, cast a match, because I get to hang out with Nathan a fair bit as a person, but I don't think I've ever gotten to actually cast any of his matches. And, you know, aggro decks in general have a little bit of a negative moniker. You know, people are like, they're easy to play. But I think watching Chalky play earlier, and he said that him and Nathan brought very similar lineups, we've seen there's a lot of decision-making for aggro decks. You have to know, when is it time to actually go face? Should I be trading? You know, what do I actually do in these situations? And, you know, Admirable, way, way back in the day, was playing these decks, going back into the America's Championship in 2014.
Yeah. And I know Raven considers himself a hunter connoisseur.
Yeah,
so you know the
maybe, you know, I've been hurt recently by the lack of power that class has at the moment. But yeah, I like Hunter. I think it might not be the best deck at the moment to bring to this tournament, as we've seen. You know, it can perform well versus Paladin, things like that. But I think overall, there are just more powerful decks. You look at Zoo, if you want to play a slightly more aggressive deck, it's based on board control.
Yeah, I have a really good Hunter deck that I want you to try out.
Don't
later.
Even start. Okay.
Trust me, all of the North American players are playing it on the ladder in top 10.
Maybe there's a theme here. You know. Yeah.
No, the theme here is that you're new, and he's done this to everybody who he's casted it over the course of the week. And he'll be like, got this great deck. You just got to try it out. And I've learned that when TJ says that, you're just like, nah, I'm going to play Druid.
What's worse is I trusted you at the start, in the beginning, and now it's just all gone out the window.
TJ's a very trustworthy guy. He's the first person I ever cast at Hearthstone with, actually, back in the Fireside Gathering Championship in 2015, so can be trusted. Now, also looking at these lineups, it's clear that Admirable, trusting more aggressive lineup of Druid, Warlock, Paladin, has the Warrior banned out. For Nostim, why do you ban the Warrior?
Why do you ban the Warrior? He's playing Freeze Mage. 100%. With his lineup, he's got a very aggressive lineup, so with Freeze Mage, you don't want to find yourself in a Warrior mirror.
That's
for obvious reasons.
We don't want to find ourselves in a Warrior mirror.
That's for us more than anything, but yeah. Okay.
Resident Sleeper, tank up.
Right, you actually gave me a very solid answer, but I was looking for was the joke answer about the clinic you and Nathan put on at PAX with Patron Warrior. That was brutal to watch.
Oh,
but,
my goodness.
Ooh, Nostim looks like he's opening with Patron, and that's Admirable. He's actually just Gul'dan. He's not even, we don't see his picture.
Yeah.
Too evil for the
screen. The beard's right, though. That's The beard's pretty on point there for Gul'dan.
Actually, it's a little bit smaller. It's a little bit smaller than Nathan's beard. Nathan's beard is probably the bushiest beard in all of Hearthstone.
I cast him with him at PAX, and he said, "Oh, I just went to the barbershop, and my barber cut like 2 inches off my beard. I'm pissed."
What a positive.
It was clean. It was nice and clean. He's like, ah.
What an admirable thing to say.
Yeah.
So out of interest, TJ, what type of zoo deck do you think this is?
Oh, admirable?
Leroy.
Because I'm pretty confident it's the list that curves out 5. Maybe with a Dr. Boom, maybe. But
yeah. I actually watch Admirable stream occasionally. He plays for the esports gaming team, which is sort of like a satire about, you know, those some Hearthstone teams. It's really funny. And yeah, he does play the double Doom Guard, Lotheb list that stops right there. So, and Nasim, he was actually playing the Warrior list that I gave Raven, but it looks like he decided to switch it up and go with Patron.
I wonder why.
What was your record with that Raven in the hotel? It was like 0-13.
It wasn't quite that. It felt like it should have been. If I chose to carry on with the deck, but I swiftly identified that the deck was bad. So I'm probably going to get strung up for saying that. I'm escaping back to EU soon, so I'm up to just shy away from all these NA players.
Great deck.
Bloodsail Corsair off the Dark Peddler, and this is one of those few circumstances where Bloodsail Corsair is actually a great pickup. Mm-hmm. Warrior weapons that we're going to be seeing probably all just have 2 toughness. So first one comes out, and then you just throw a knife at it.
Yeah, or you know, if they just get really greedy and equip it, you can just tap into Bran really quick. Brand Bloodsail Corsair actually takes out 2 charges of a weapon. So that's very anti-warrior.
What an idea. This is now, TJ, you've been talking over the weekend. You're currently ranked pretty high on the ladder and you're going for those spring season points. This is,
yes, I am.
I can see that Hearthstone IQ in action and you're clearly making the go for it.
I think I've racked up 3 points. A lot of people out there have been seeing me in opens and have been defeated by me in opens. So keep an eye on me for the spring. I'll be playing all of the decks that I've given Raven over the past 3 days. I'm sandbagging right now, making everybody believe that the decks are terrible.
Oh, the true long con there.
Exactly.
But because I feel like I'm going to be the voice of reason on this desk, what do you guys actually think of Corcoran in Patron Warrior? As it's definitely one of those stylistic choices. You see Corcoran, or you see some like Shredders are pretty common, or Double Corsair, for example.
Corcoran Elite is one of those cards that's proactive on the board. Patron's win condition is not really to have a really sticky board because whatever comes out of a Pilot Shredder, they don't have much use for. Where Corcoran Elite, they have immediate board impact. You can use it for burst, you can use it to clear off like an Imp Gang boss, which is super powerful, especially since Zeus is so prevalent. And you're the one being proactive. You're not letting your opponent dictate the course of the board. So I really like the Corcoran Elite choice more so than the Piloted Shredder choice in that 4 slot.
Yeah, I think it's definitely good to just pile on that extra little bit of pressure because sometimes, obviously, post-nerf Patron doesn't have a lot of burst straight off the bat, but with Corcoran, you can push a little bit more to maybe get in, like, Grom in a Rage. Right?
Yeah.
Actually, I want to point out, there's still a fair amount of burst in Patron. I mean, you still got the Frothing Berserker. Still got Grom, you still got weapons. It's just not quite as much burst. Like obviously,
it's not quite just from hand.
I was going to say, in this day and age in Hearthstone, we talk about what constitutes burst damage. Like back in the original days of Hearthstone, you're like, whoa, 5 damage on Doomguard, that's a lot of burst. Now we're like, yeah, it's not quite so much burst anymore.
Flame Imp, a 3-2 on turn 1?
You got to be, well, that's a, okay, that's still pretty good, though. That's still actually pretty good. And Admiral's built himself a really imposing board. And you know, one of the ways that Patron wins this matchup is just to kind of get in a situation where you put down Unstable Ghoul, you get your Whirlwind effects from the Deathbite from Whirlwind itself, and you just kind of clear the board and make a bunch of Patrons, but Nostrum's hand is kind of flooded with these cards that'd be probably better suited to dealing with Druid.
Yeah, in Patron versus Zoo, as the Patron player, if you clear the board once, you win.
Yeah.
That's pretty much how it is, and you have a lot of tools to do it, like you said, the Unstable Ghoul, Deathbite. Even if you just get to a situation where you make a lot of Patrons, you pretty much win also, because Implosion plus a really strong board is the only ways you can counter that.
I want to point out, we see this slam to take out the 3-2, conserve some health for Nostrum. TJ, as someone who plays a lot of Patron, do you like that, or would you have played Greedy? Would you have tried to go for the cycle to get that Patron?
No, I like that, because he realizes that he's in a situation where he has to be proactive. He has to make the board as little as possible, because he doesn't really have a follow-up play. He just has two Frothing Berserkers.
Yeah, I think something he's got to be aware of as well is because the egg is actually on one health, if he gets Patron, has a Whirlwind effect, he needs to sort of be able to deal with that Nerubian as well. Because, you know, as you noted, he's sort of guarding his health because it's getting pretty low and the board is still there. And there's always a threat that Whirlwind looks kind of nice to just clear up all the tokens, but then you create a 4-4 for your opponent.
Coming up, the greatest decision Admiral will have to make. Turn 7, Dr. Rune, and obviously there's not enough space, so you have to sacrifice some things. But do you play Blitzel Corsair? Obviously that weapon's going to die, but it just the looking at that turn would have just been like
it would have been
things.
Tense.
It would have been. A lot of
what
tension.
What would you have done, Rob?
I think I would have had to take him upstairs, hit him with the old Bloodsail Corsair, and he still can. Look it. Nossum is mind gaming in ways he doesn't know.
Yeah. Nossum's looking very serious right now.
He's always admirable, to be fair.
Yeah. Very true.
Yeah. No, he's not gonna fall for the trap. He's just gonna play the Dr. Boom. Mm-hmm. He's like Bloodsail Corsair does destroy a weapon, but
yeah,
Dr. Boom's pretty good as well.
Yeah, we haven't seen a Patron or a Despite drawn this whole game so far for Nossum. And those are the two most important cards for a lot of matchups. Mostly Despite. Patron, you say that. Oh, well, speaking of Despite, Patron, you say that because against Zoo, a lot of times, building a board full of Patrons is how you win the game. But again, the Bloodsail Corsair just waiting to strike.
Oh, he's lying and waiting, and when that Death Bite comes out, Admiral's gonna be very excited to play down that Bloodsail Corsair and destroy that weapon prematurely, because so much of the Patron's game plan is just predicated around waiting for that Death Bite proc. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this ghoul's actually a little bit of a problem because the board looks really nice for Nostum. So the ghoul AoE that almost it can't be ignored because there's no owl, for example, in Admirable's hand, and it's going to buff the Frothing. The only hope is that maybe the Boombots actually kill off the Frothing Berserker or something like that, just to get it off the board, because there's still a chance that Nostum can, you know, like level the game out with Despite and then with Grom. He could actually just flip the game around if this Berserker can't get answered.
Yeah, I really like this play here though. He's, you know, of course, Powerful Wing first, making sure that he gets his sequencing right so that it lives through the unstable ghoul, because he realizes the only way he's going to be able to clear through to that Frothing Berserker. Also, gets a huge Boombot to kill off the Armorsmith.
Exactly. Admirable would be proud. And the fact that he has the follow-up as well, so he made that clear, which didn't really look fantastic in terms of what he wants to accomplish overall, but the fact that you can do that and then drop Juggler, Flame Him, and a Gang Boss, it's so much pressure, and we're probably going to see now the Grom have to clear these minions up.
I kind of wonder if we're going to get to that point where Admiral Bull's just going to get impatient, drop the Bloodsail Corsair, and then the Deathbite's going to be like, no!
Yeah. Well, this will be definitely a test of his patience, but I don't think there's any reason to play, just because it's a 1-2. How much impact is a 1-2 really going to have on board?
TJ, that's one extra damage to the face. Let me just...
Okay.
To the dome.
To the dome,
of course.
Consider who we're casting here.
Yeah.
He really values face damage.
Yeah.
Doesn't look like it. He's not going to fall for this trap, and out comes the Despite. Admirable is vindicated. He is going to get to Bloodsail Corsair that. And
the thing is, since this is taking out the Imp King... Oh, nope, just kidding. I was going to say, since this is taking out the Imp King boss, he wouldn't have had enough damage to finish off that Frothing Berserker had he... Oh, that's just icing on the cake.
Well, now let's look at this. So Bloodsail Corsair, and then you trade everything, basically.
Really good plan.
Yeah.
Bloodsail Corsair, trade stuff, and then BJ.
Some high-level insight from the host role on the desk. This is why I told you Leroy was in this. I told you.
And I said that the Duke list was running BGH and Leroy.
We've not seen Sea Giants yet, so until I see the Sea Giant, I just won't believe you.
This is working against my plan to counter my original plan. I'm starting to be right.
I love Nossum's face, and it's just, bad times. And Leroy just sitting in hand, and I love this deck. This is a good Zoo deck right here, Leroy in it. I love throwing Leroy in as many decks as possible.
If this is the true Chinese version, then he runs Enhanced Omakano in this deck. So,
well, it's not something we're going to get to find out, it looks like, because Admirable's going to go ahead and finish it off. Time's up.
I kind of want to see him to tap.
Let's do this.
Just to get a little bit further into
the deck. I want to see what else is in this.
He's like, I want to be right. I want to get him to tap into a Doomguard so I can rub it in TJ's face.
But in all seriousness, Admirable not tapping to not reveal any further information about, you know, the potential ongoing in the tournament.
Also, just as a sign of respect, you know, he respects Nossum, doesn't feel the need to BM him a little bit, and You know, Nathan's one of those people who enjoy some tasteful BM from time to time, but goes ahead and just takes his win. He's up 1-0 on Nostum, and his Zoo deck now out of the running.
Yeah, very true. And that's one thing that you need to do is, and Conquest is sort of the opposite as last year's standing, if that's a format that you're used to, because it's the winning deck that wants to try and, well, both decks actually want to try and conceal more information, but the winning deck is the one where you don't want to give your opponents that you might play in the future any information when you're playing on stream. The loser doesn't want to give information to their opponents that they're playing in that match because they, of course, have to win with that deck.
Yeah. But no, a really solid play from Admirable overall. It's kind of weird. I think he'll be happy with that win because it's not like the best matchup at all for Zoo. And the patron deck just like suffering so hard. And then Admirable has gained that knowledge though. So the Corcoran Elite, for example, that's something really important to know because as we discussed previously, there's a very big difference between the Corcoran versus the Shredder.
Yeah.
Zoo has kind of been overcoming a lot of unfavorable matchups today. Not that they were necessarily like 90-10 bad, but they're more like kind of 60-40 against them. The Freeze Mage matchup, the patron matchup. The good news for Nostum is Admirable still has Secret Paladin, and that's an excellent place for Patron to shine.
Yeah, that's very true. Patron does do well against that. They can control the board early and not let them, you know, snowball out of control. But yeah, going back to your point of Zoo really quickly, I talked to a lot of players, the Rat, Muzzy, Chalky, even that's Admirable. They all say that Zoo is the best deck in the game and has been for a long time. There's statistics to prove it also, but that's their opinion because I don't have the statistics with me to prove it out. But Zoo is the best deck.
Well, from a community standpoint now, we often see, you know, players talk about decks they don't necessarily enjoy dealing with, and Zoo has kind of made a resurgence in terms of being a deck the players are suddenly okay with again. And, you know, in 2014, it was obviously a way different story. It was like, Zoo, I don't like this deck. But now people are like, yeah, Zoo's a very skill-testing deck. I really like this deck.
Yeah, they basically just count how many people tweet at Play Hearthstone, when will you delete Life Tap?
Right, yeah, just Zoo's in a very good spot right now.
Yeah.
Players love it. And again, when you play it really well, it is one of those decks that can be incredibly powerful. There's a lot of decisions you have to make in terms of minion placement, kind of what you're playing when, how heavily you play into board clear. We saw earlier, Hologrin, unfortunately, overplayed into Priest board removal and was punished for it. So a lot of decisions you make when you play Zoo.
Yeah, and I think also you talk about Zoo early on in Hearthstone's life being like very, you know, unliked. But I think as time has gone on and people learn more and more and people are always getting better at the game, they actually appreciate the intricacies in certain decks even more. So it's kind of good to see that. I kind of like Zoo. But this match is going to be Admirable on his Druid versus Nostum on his Patron Warrior again.
I think both players have really solid opening hands. If you're Nostum, this hand looks a lot better for Patron than kind of what your opening hand was, because I believe, as we've said over the course of the day, the way you beat Druid is really quickly make Patrons. Don't let the Druid have the ability to clear the board, and then you just kind of go from there.
Really does need a Deathbite, though.
Yeah.
The cards that you're looking for against Druid, Fireworks is not an auto-keep, because a lot of players don't run Darnassus Aspirant. The first thing that you're able to hit with the Fireworks is a Powder Shredder usually. And by that time, you usually want to play Deathbite anyway, because you're probably going to want to make Patrons in that following turn or even the turn after that. So it's a good hand, but he really needs a Deathbite or some kind of extra Whirlwind effect in order to play to his strengths in the Druid matchup.
Now, Nostum choosing to equip the Fiery War Axe there, overplay the Armorsmith. Raven, why do you think he chose that?
So the reason for the War Axe is Druid's not going to really run any early weapon removal, so he doesn't get punished by just having the two charges, not necessarily attacking, but it's definitely a tempo advantage because Armorsmith doesn't do anything against Druid early on. All their minions are pretty big, other than maybe Living Roots, which would have been played by now. So there's no like advantage of getting that on the board early, whereas just locking in a weapon while you can and then just saving it for when's relevant is actually really useful. And he doesn't have the Death Bite, as you mentioned, TJ, so it's not like, oh, if I play this and then have nothing to attack with, I have to overlap it with Death Bite and just lose the weapon completely. He is going to get some good use out of it. Speak
to me. Yeah, now this was a tough choice here. He had the option of coining out the Corcoran Elite to immediately deal with Micro Machine, which when it's first played, there hasn't been any turns that it's been on the board. It's one attack. So that it feels like such a good trade, but you can't really afford to use the coin this early against Druid, especially when they have Wild Growth. You need that ramp tool, that coin, to play into a huge power play, not just a Corcoran Elite that takes out a Micro Machine. So I like that he holds onto the coin.
Unfortunately, by doing so, he allowed Admirable to just play down the Druid of the Claw. That comes out 4-6 taunt. Going to be really difficult for Nostum to get through if he doesn't have the execute, which we see he does not. And that Micro Machine is just going to continue to get value. And, you know, this is a matchup that is generally favored for the Patron player. But if Druid can push enough damage early, it gets really hairy for the Patron player.
Yeah, because they don't really have a true comeback mechanic when the minions are so high health. There's so mid-range minions, like against something like Paladin, yeah, you know, a couple of whirlwind effects can often just clear the board up. But like against Druid, like, you know, you really do need to put a lot of effort in just getting that board control early. He does now get the execute, so he can either use the Corcoran with coin to do this and then hold on to the execute for something a little bit bigger, maybe a Dr. Boom drop later on. But the only option there is like he would throw the coin and have to just, the Corcoran just dies, right? So I think he looks like he's going to go for the hovering over that Frothing Berserk and being able to coin into execute, which is pretty nice.
Yeah, I was going to say, assume you see the Inner Rage come out too. Not the way you want to use Inner Rage, but anytime you can just kind of get the board from Druid, rest control of it, and force the Druid to start addressing what you're doing, as opposed to just continue to play these beefy mid-range threats, it's a win for the patron.
Yeah, and also Frothing Berserk is actually kind of awkward for the Druid to deal with. It's already buffed with a little bit extra damage, and it's like, if you just swipe that, which looks like the cleanest thing to do, well, you just swipe a single minion on the board. So, and it's 4 mana of a 6 mana turn, so that's not great either. So, you know, Nostrum actually just, you know, cashing in on that Frothing Berserk and having it still active, and maybe he can do some more damage now to be able to either take out Lotheb or just go face and start putting the pressure on.
Yeah, he's still missing those death spites though, and that Lotheb really puts a cramp in his style. Whoa. So an Ancient of War.
You assume he's going to uproot it, right?
Of course.
He's going to the dome.
Yeah. He's heading upstairs.
I was going to say, do we know any more? I think it's to the dome, upstairs.
Huge.
Do we have anything else? If you could tweet us, use the hashtag HCT to get us more admirable memes.
Hashtag HTC, right. HCT, and hashtag admirableisms.
Admirableisms.
If you could spell it.
That's a lot easier than hashtag that's memorable. Nostrum is unfortunately once again in the position now where he is addressing the Druid's board. And, you know, for Admirable, you've seen one execute. I have to imagine that Ancient of War feels like a pretty spicy play scene.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be a rough one because Ancient of War is something that sort of used to be standard in a lot of mid-range Druid, and then it sort of disappeared where everyone just wanted to just double combo everyone to death. But now it's just crawling back. There are even some lists that run two Ancient of War with just one combo that's sort of like popping up now and again. But the one Ancient of War does a lot of work, and even against decks like Secret Paladin as well that don't too often run Iron Beak Owl.
We see now with a huge board Admirable has constructed. Thank you. TJ looked at me in the appropriate fashion.
This is nuts.
Ancient of War and Keeper of the Grove can both come out next turn thanks to the Emperor Thor's name discount. So.
Yeah.
But Dr. Boom is, well, never mind.
Yeah.
I was going to say, that's pretty, this swipe's going to do work. Go ahead and attack with Thor's hand first, get that damage in. And then, yeah, you probably have to do it with Dr. Boom. All right, see what we get from these Boom Bots.
Yeah, and the good thing about the swipe here as well is that although the Ancient of War is delayed, he doesn't need it to be on the board yet. There's nothing here, you know, there's no board pressure whatsoever. So Admirable going straight to the dome with that Keeper of the Grove, just two to the face.
I like it. You know, I realize there's nothing I really need to silence. Of course, in the patron matchup there is, because it's patrons. You have to deal 2 damage to patrons. So this is one of those aggressive plays where if he wins, we're like, wow, what a forward-thinking play. Got to get that damage in. And if the patrons cut out, we're like, Nathan, you can't be that aggressive, man.
Yeah, this has got to be the setup for an uproot, though, as you said earlier, Rob. I think it's the only thing that can really be done. You've seen an execute, and if you uproot, you force Grom into it anyway, and they actually trade with Grom, so that could be a play.
In this universe, this singular universe,
please,
I believe uproot
Admirable
is the correct play.
Yes! We got it!
We've uprooted!
We did it!
Hearthstone Championship Tour action, uproot.
We did it, Reddit!
We did it, Reddit.
How to win in style by Admirable.
Wow. Even Nostrum can't help but crack a smile on that one.
If you're going to lose, you kind of want to lose to uproot an Ancient of War.
Yeah.
Is he going to just fire War Axe and just hit that Ancient of War and be like, yeah, okay.
I mean,
this has happened.
Yeah, there's actually no way that he could be punished because an execute would have killed it anyway.
Yep.
Right.
And this way, in order to proc it with a weapon, he has to take 10 damage and he dies.
No, we're celebrating here because this is such a rare sight. But to be sure, that was the actual correct line of play.
That was the correct play, yeah.
Yeah, if Grom would have actually been on, say, like 5 health, you know, maybe you just play the taunt anyway. But because of not, like, at worst, like you said, it either has some funky way to get executed or he has to run the Grom in.
Well, this is quite an interesting turn of events.
What a draw, though. That's going to deal with that pesky Grom without you taking 10
damage.
And
he's got a lot of outs for lethal here.
That's not one of them.
Yeah, that's a little disappointing for him, I'm sure. But this could be a turnaround for Nostrum, because look at his hand. He has Armorsmith and Patron. He has no Whirlwind effects, but if he draws into a Whirlwind effect...
Right, you see Admirable's on no cards now. So the odds of him having like some combination of Wrath, Keeper of the Grove, Swipe to deal with his board, very low.
Yeah, and after this turn, his outs are going to be limited to Force of Nature. Swipe no longer provides lethal. This could get down to the wire if Admiral doesn't have a... Ooh, Savage Roar is not it.
Now, this is... We went back to this matchup last year for the Round of 40 North American Tournament. This was pre-changed to Warsong Commander, so obviously Patron wasn't just overall by the numbers stronger deck, but we've talked about the fact that the Druid draws were traditionally a lot stronger than versus the Patron ones. Maybe not necessarily so much the case, as Patron has kind of evolved into this more mid-range oriented deck, where you have things like Shredder, you have things like Dr. Boom, so obviously you've already seen Dr. Boom, but yeah, I have to think that the Patron is a little bit better spot now.
Yeah.
This is a tough call, though.
Instantly played.
That huge Ancient of Lore on the screen.
An actual huge Ancient of Lore. That Ancient of Lore is going to give him some much-needed card draw, though, and we'll see what he ends up actually getting. If he gets a combo, he's just in business.
Disease are going into Nostrum's deck.
That's got to be a foul somewhere.
Yeah, yeah. Who get an admin ruling?
That's a yellow card where I'm from. Yeah. We'll see what Nostrum picks up. We get that Unstable Ghoul. Unstable Ghoul, not necessarily a bad thing since he has that Patron down, and it would soak up some hits from a possible combo, but rest assured, if that combo can be cast, Nostrum is dead.
Yeah, so we got an update of exactly what cards Admirable picked up from that Ancient of Lore since we can't see them in the hand. It's a second Ancient of Lore and a copy of Living Roots.
Well, if you have to Ancient of Lore into something at this point, Ancient of Lore into Ancient of Lore is pretty good.
Yeah, and the thing is as well, like Living Roots can still hit for two, right? And you can aim that at face. So with a Savage Roar, then Living Roots, it's actually a significant amount of damage just from the Druid itself. Never mind if, say, there's another Druid of the Claw drawn or something like that.
TJ, you actually brought this up, that a lot of the decks, especially in the Western scene, have cut Darnassus Aspirin and are just using purely like two copies of Living Roots now.
Yeah.
That's actually one of those things where when you're playing against a Druid, you're like, no, I'm at 16 health. You can't kill me. I'm at 15 health. And then they have 10 mana, and then they combo and also just ping you for two at Living Roots.
Yeah, it's something that you definitely have to keep in mind nowadays. Admirable is running a list that sort of gets the best of all of the worlds. He has Azure Drakes, he has Ancient of Wars, he has Darnassus Aspirant, and he has Living Roots.
Although we couldn't quite tell there, I think that was actually double Living Roots to face. It looked like he queued the same spell twice, and the Living Roots animation popped up twice, so... Might have to find out in that one.
Say, this is a whole other level of casting Hearthstone.
Yeah, well, somebody lost because a hero portrait just exploded.
And we are getting word. Yeah. Admirable has gone up 2-0 and going to take a really commanding lead in this series. Not super surprising the way that game was going. Drawing in a double Ancient of Lore when both you and your opponent are kind of low on cards. Pretty great way to get back into that game, get some resources, and then just start pushing damage as is basically just the Druid MO.
Yeah. It could have been a comeback, though. I mean, Nostrum had some chances there at the end. One more draw away, and he could have had a Whirlwind effect that could have given him 6-7 armor, depending on how many patrons he could have propagated onto the board. That's a word I haven't used in a while.
Propagating patrons.
Yes.
And even potential from the back of that, like a Battle Rage to then refill hand and then continue from there. But like you said, with Ancient of Lore into Ancient of Lore, it's so much card draw when there's just so many outs as well for Admirable when the Warrior's on that low health. It would have been really difficult for the Warrior to take that game.
Right, and for Nostrum now, still has to get 3 wins if he wants to take this series. Knows Admirable's going to be playing Paladin, so I'm sure Nostrum's getting ready to queue a Patron and thinks, this time for sure.
This time for sure. We haven't seen Admirable yet, so I'm guessing he's playing Secret Paladin because Admirable's a guy that, you know, when he's in a super competitive mode, he plays what he thinks is best.
I like the way this analogy for Nathan, like he's in his like caterpillar and butterfly form. When he's in his ultra competitive butterfly form, he just wants to win, so he's going to play what he deems are the most powerful decks. And I wouldn't be surprised. My appraisal of the situation is basically the same as yours. I doubt we're going to see any egg hijinks or anything.
Yeah, I played a best of 5 against Admirable once, and I left crying. So that's how competitive he is.
Did you really cry, TJ?
No, but I wanted to.
Okay.
But you can't cry around Admirable.
He senses weakness.
So you look into his eyes, and then it automatically goes down to his beard, and your tears just like suck back up into your head. So
wow,
it's tough.
This is some high quality role play right here. I don't think it's ever going to get better than this. But
yeah.
Nostrum still has access to Hunter and Mage. Could choose to go those directions if he's feeling the Patron deck just isn't giving him what he wants. Maybe bench the Patron deck for a turn. Still has to beat Paladin 3 times, which is pretty tall order.
Yeah, well, the thing is, though, looking at his lineup in general, obviously we don't know what the other two decks are at this moment in time, but the Warrior is going to be a good matchup, you'd imagine. Even Hunter's pretty good. And if that's, say, like, even either variant of Mage in terms of tempo or freeze are both perform pretty well versus Secret Paladin.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's definitely something he can do. It's not, you know, completely impossible with this lineup to beat Secret Paladin, but Secret Paladin is a very, you know, it's very steady deck, very consistent.
I actually think all three of Nostum's remaining decks are favored against Secret Paladin. He tends to run a really aggressive Hunter, Face Hunter. I'm 99% sure that it's Freeze Mage. Watch me be wrong. And Patron Warrior also is a very strong matchup against Secret Paladin.
Right, and you talk about the fact Nossum has this hyper-aggressive Hunter. This is basically the only archetype of Hunter that I feel has a good matchup against this Paladin deck, and kind of the way you look to win this is you're basically hoping just to completely dodge Shielded Minibot on turn two. You just do not want to see this card, but you want to get down your own one drop. You want to get down something like a Mad Scientist or Knife Juggler. Your traps are usually like something like Bear Trap, something like Explosive Trap, and then you're just, once they muster, you unleash, and you're like, nope, going face. Just, that's the play. You're not interested in trading. Like, this, it's actually as close to kind of the Smork references this deck really gets. You just trade basically only with the Knife Juggler, and then you try to just get past those Noble Sacrifices, and Worgen Infiltrator is such a good opening card.
Yeah, I think the really strong benefit for the Hunter is the hero power like truly raises the Paladin, because Secret Paladin doesn't really run any healing past the potential of a true silver plus two. So, you know, the pressure you put on with that hero power and trying to just squeeze a hero power in every turn, maybe after turn four or five, really starts to stack up. And if the Paladin's kept on the back foot, they can't really recover fast enough to take the win a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Nossum sees that Shielded Minibot come out, which is one of those cards that I really feel like you want to dodge. And for him, he now has to get into the idea of trading, and the Knife Juggler has to die. Like, you can't leave that up. Going into turn three, just can't have that Knife Juggler on the board, but very curious to see, he's probably going to, wow, he doesn't ignore the Minibot. TJ, why would you not ignore the Minibot there?
Well, he wants a fresh board, and he knows that the next turn is a Muster for Battle turn, and I'm actually surprised he didn't go with the Archangel on there, because, well, I know why, but a lot of times you can't resist. On an empty board playing an Arcane Golem, he doesn't want to get him a faster Mysterious Challenger, because usually the only thing that stops you from raising a Paladin is if they get out their Mysterious Challenger really quickly to contest the board. So,
speaking of really quickly, how fast are these guys playing this game? This is...
They know how this matchup goes.
Hyper speed.
Yeah.
But also about the Juggler as well, like going into turn three, you just expect Muster. Yeah. So he already had a two drop, and if he drew another one drop or two drop, then you can then hopefully get a couple more Juggles out and actually clear off some of that Muster. So I kind of like that play, but we do see Arcane Golem now, and look at this pressure, it's ridiculous.
It's like there's no minions. Nostum didn't get the memo that this is actually the Hearthstone America's preliminary, not the Tavern Brawl from this week.
No, yeah, I was going to say, Admirable's face definitely has taunt here.
Yes,
he's
does.
Definitely going for it. And, you know, Nossum sitting on two quick shots and a hero power. So at the very least, is what, 8 damage in hand?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That is a lot of direct damage. I'm excited. As a Hunter player.
Sorry for the silence, but we were just appreciating that, Rob. We were just like, yes, good work.
You know, Dan brought it up earlier in the day. I am a Hunter player through and through, so watching that just fills me with such a dark glee. Just seeing the quick shot, seeing the kill command in hand, the hair power, I'm like, yes, all the damage.
Look at those hand motions.
I need a minute, guys. Just carry the desk.
I'll push your chair over there so you can have your minute. Oh, geez. But yeah, I mean, I think both players sort of expected that. Not many people are playing Hunter, but I think it capitalizes on the weaknesses of some of the more popular decks. It does pretty well against Zoo, and a lot of the time, it just absolutely destroys Secret Paladin, as you can see there. They flood the board. You just go face. A lot of times, Secret Paladins don't have a way to block damage, aside from maybe a Sludge Belcher or a Noble Sacrifice, and they usually don't even get much past turn six.
Yeah, I think to win that matchup as the Paladin, the Hunter either has to, like you said, not get like the early drop straight away, or the Paladin has to just go insane and get that actual Noble Sacrifice down, because that sucks up so much damage whilst conserving the board yourself, so then you can start pressuring.
Yeah, that was probably the fastest turn of a match we've ever witnessed. This one will be considerably slower. It's time for Freeze Mage versus Secret Paladin.
Yeah, and Nossum has sort of put his Patron Warrior in timeout for now. Because he lost him 2 games in a row. He's a little mad at it. But Freeze Mage actually is a good matchup against Secret Paladin. Now, it's not hyper-favored. A lot of players will think, oh, it's like a pretty much auto-loss. Secret Paladin still does have Lothab. They still can curve out incredibly well. They can put out very scary boards. So you still need to play well and in some cases draw well if you want to count on winning this matchup.
Yeah, and especially the addition of the secrets and the way they interact makes board clearing actually quite difficult when there's cards like Minibot on board and, yeah, you know, a Coghammer use, because then they've got to sort of, they clear the board, but then buff the minions that get left over. So then it's just like, oh, okay, I've sort of used the board clear, but I'm under so much pressure still with the extra damage that's been given from, say, Avenge, that you can just continue to build up on that and then go into cards like you said, TJ, of the like the low Theb, and then, you know, even Dr. Boom as well is, you know, generally accepted very good against Freeze Mage.
Yeah.
Yeah, when we look here at Admirable's opening hand, it's actually, I don't feel like it's super great against a Freeze Mage. Takes a little bit of time to get going. That Keeper of Voldemon, or both of those Keepers of Voldemon, rather, could be used to buff up the 1-1 tokens to being 3-3s, but kind of promote them, graduate them from 1-1 life. But in general, where the Freeze Mage tends to find problems with this matchup is they need very specific things at specific times. Where a Secret Paladin, much like Zoo, it's just kind of constantly drawing into these things that are very annoying to deal with. And Freeze Mage has to have the answer, and Paladin just constantly asking the question.
Yeah, they sort of just throw up their hand every turn and trade on the board. Those are the types of plays that Zoo and Secret
Paladin make. Is that your Secret Paladin deck guide?
Yeah.
You just throw stuff on the board and win? But speaking of answers, you know, the Frost Nova into Doomsay is already available. So that's actually pretty huge, because not all Secret Paladins run the Owl. So just being able to guarantee on turn 5, you can create a really sticky situation for the Paladin to have to try and deal with that, or the board's clear, because you really want to build that board up for the turn you play Mysterious Challenger, because it's so much more effective when there's more minions on the board.
This is one of those matchups where the Repentance tech in your secret repertoire, it actually makes a big difference, because if you play Mysterious Challenger, your opponent, if it's a Freeze Mage, is definitely going to want to use a Blizzard Doomsayer or Frost Nova Doomsayer. And if you can get a Doomsayer down to 1 health with Repentance, as sort of your fourth secret, you can kill it off easily with a Coghammer, with a True Silver Champion, with a Light's Justice. So that's a definitely a good tech in this matchup.
I really thought you were going to go through and just list all the sources of one damage in a Paladin deck. Like, that's
Knife Juggler.
Anything. Yeah. A stiff breeze. Thankfully, that was just the weapons.
And so, unfortunately, you can't Steam Weedle Sniper from a pile of Shredder and place a dude
on someone's face.
On the Doomsayer.
Just throw a dude in someone's face.
I will smush your one health Doomsayer with my Steam Weedle Snipered Silverhand Recruit.
Let the record show. I did not expect this to be nearly as much of a roleplay desk as it was, but we've really gotten that in there.
Dream team.
The meme team, more like it, TJ. But looking at Admiral's hand, he's got that Mysterious Challenger on 6, so this is kind of an interesting talking point. Obviously, Mysterious Challenger, very powerful card, the bane of many people's ladder existence, but it's not super, well, I would say it's not super, it's not as good against Freeze Mage, because Freeze Mage doesn't do a whole lot of interacting with the board, so a lot of what makes the card more annoying isn't necessarily as crazy. Obviously, Competitive Spirit, which is usually a one-off thing, is more of kind of an issue, but that said, you still play it on 6, right?
Oh yeah. It's just a super strong card, and Raven made a good point earlier talking about the interaction between secrets and board clears. It's just so hard to fully clear a Paladin board, and if you leave one creature, that's the target that they need for the Blessing of Kings to slam into your face for 12. So it's really tough. And Nalsim, we see he's actually on the plan, which is a popular Freeze Mage plan against Secret Paladin, is to just go face. If you don't get removal, and you don't get secrets, and you don't get card draw, but you get all your burn, you just start pointing the spells at face and go for it. If he pings over the next couple turns, he'll be in a good spot.
Well, now he actually has it anyway. He has 19 damage. He just has to wait for that Pyro. So if he goes Frostbolt now, he Fireballs next turn, and then he can just survive till turn 10, unless the Paladin gets like a True Silver out and heals for a little bit more. But with the pings each turn as well, like that's just already lethal is available.
Yeah. The thing will be getting to that turn 10, because this is, it still will be an intimidating board, because the redemption, oh no, it still brings back a Silverhand Recruit. That's correct. But like you said, the Avenge, he still has Blessing of Kings. He has Keeper of Voldemon to buff up these spiders that are going to pop out.
These spiders need to hit the gym, but you know, thankfully there's something there. You can just, and more importantly, he can double up. He doesn't have to choose which one of those spiders gets to get buffed. Both of them can get buffed.
Very true. Blizzard's actually a great draw, though, because it allows him to fill in that ping.
Yeah.
And it buys him another turn, which is a big thing. So Fireball next turn, like you said.
Yeah, and he still even has, like, worst-case scenario, say both of these keepers come down now. He has Flamestrike. So it's just, like, it's just going to lock the board down so hard that there's almost just nothing Admirable can do here.
Right, that's an interesting point. So a deck that is so singularly focused on its win condition, like Secret Paladin, it's just raw power, raw power, raw power, I'm just going to muscle you out of the game, often falls a little bit short in situations like these. Admirable is not a stupid guy. He knows, he's an incredibly intelligent guy. Knows exactly what's going on, can probably see the writing on the wall, can't do anything about it, though. The only thing he can really do is try to race, and obviously he just keeps seeing stop signs in the form of freeze spells, and you know, Nossum's just on a plan where he's just going to have it on turn 10.
Yeah, unless he draws into Eye for an Eye and can put Nossum to 10, then he's dead next turn. Even a True Silver draw would have, he still would have died because Nossum picked up that Blizzard, was able to fit in another ping. So played it super well. That's a tough win condition to spot, especially for rookie Freeze Mage players, because they're so focused on, I need to clear this board, I need to clear this board. They don't start counting the damage until after their Alexstrasza, but that's a mistake. You need to start counting your damage really early on.
Well, obviously, Nossum is no rookie. He is going to find this Pyroblast. He is going to drag it all the way across the board into Admirable's face, and he's going to tie the series 2-2. And for Admirable, you know, I joked. I was like, yeah, it just has to get a win with Secret Paladin, but as you pointed out, all of these decks that Nossum has do pretty admirably. Dramatic pause, TJ, please.
Good one.
Thanks. Against Secret Paladin.
Yeah, and he just has the Patron Warrior left. And Patron Warrior does struggle sometimes with its inconsistency nowadays. Yeah, sometimes it doesn't get the right draws.
And he's definitely going to be worried about that because he's not had the most fun Patron matches so far. And I really think it's reliant in the Patron versus Secret Paladin where you need to get those Patrons on the board on turn 5, because if Mysterious Challenger comes down before that happens, you really need the exact answers to deal with the board, or it'll just run. It's just too much damage, and you need to use so much mana in setting up the patrons. If you try and do that afterwards, it's just going to be too slow.
Right, it's kind of like parlor tricks leading up to that those patron turns. But you know, you can play down your Unstable Gold and like, all right, this deals with a muster. You can play your Whirlwind, that deals with a muster. Maybe takes out some minions. But at the end of the day, you really do just need to draw those patrons and pretty much assert the board. Because much like Zoo, once you take the board against Secret Paladin as the patron player, you have the board. That's just how you win the game.
Yeah. But if you don't get control of the board,
right,
Secret Paladin is the class or the archetype that will punish you the most, because they have so many ways to take one small annoying creature and make it into a giant annoying creature.
So this is it, though. This is game 5. Winner of this continues along the upper bracket, has to win one more match to basically make it to the America's Winter Championship tomorrow. And, you know, for the person who loses, lower bracket destiny awaits. It's not nearly as bad as it could be, say, losing in the first round, but it's still not necessarily where you want to be. So game 5 between two great players, and that's exactly what you want to see in this situation.
Yeah, and looking at these mulligans, it's going to be interesting that Secret Keeper is always great. It's a, you know, turn 1 play, but whether he keeps the Mysterious Challenger is going to be huge, because he might choose to play like chicken with the two strategies. So it's like, I'll keep Mysterious Challenger and have it on 6, 100%. If you don't have them patrons ready for it, then it's going to propel me so far forward that that'll carry me in the game. So I'm really interested to see what Admirable chooses to do about that Challenger. As you'd imagine, the Noble Sacrifice is going to get thrown away.
Well, this is one of those situations where we might see them wait out their mulligans. Because Admirable, depending on how many cards he sees Nossum throw away, might affect his early mulligan choice. If he thinks that Nossum keeps a lot of cards, he just might think that there's a lot of weapons in the hand, so he might, you know, throw away or keep the Noble Sacrifice to protect some of his early creatures. But if he throws all those cards away, he might just hold on to the Mysterious Challenger, knowing that he's going to have a good early time anyway, because Nossum wasn't happy with his opening hand.
I really, really like what Nossum did with that mulligan. He keeps everything except the Core Crown Elite, and the Core Crown Elite is not a card that's necessarily going to get a ton of value early on against the Paladin, so tosses it back. It's a second Armorsmith, and I really like having two Armorsmiths in the opening hand. I think it's a good way to stay alive. It contests 1/1s very well, and you know, gets that Frothing Berserker, has the Deathbite, so if he does get those patrons early on, he's kind of in business.
Not too bad on the eyes, either.
Reporting for duty.
No, TJ, I'm not rewarding you for that one. I just can't do it. It's like you teach someone a bad habit. Gets that Slam, though. Slam's also super useful in this matchup. Can cycle into those patrons, can cycle into something leading to an execution.
And even just straight up removing something like a Knife Juggler or the minibot after the shield, or even removing the shield after the minibot and getting the card draw, but might not necessarily just quite need the card draw from it, but definitely need to tone the Paladin's board down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just slowly constantly whittling it down to be a lot more manageable. And don't think you can play the Frothing Berserker here. TJ, what do you think?
It's really tough because, as you mentioned earlier, Rob, I think, the win condition is to make sure, both of you, it was a team effort.
Wait, is someone going to sound smart? Because I want it to be me. I don't get many
of
those.
It was both of us, Rob. Come on.
One of your main win conditions is to have patrons down before the Mysterious Challenger comes out. And drawing two cards with Battle Rage there is pretty enticing. But, you know, he realizes that also putting a big threat on the board with Froth and Berserker, maybe getting some damage in or contesting the next threat, is also a pretty big deal. So he does forego the card draw, realizes that his hand is pretty decent with Deathbite. He might get better value out of that Battle Rage in a few turns.
Yeah, this is going to be pretty big because there was no clear way to deal with that Frothing Berserker. And as he said, with the Deathbite, you can just make this board so awkward. Whether he trades into the Shredder, probably just because the odds are that it's not going to be a 4-attack minion that comes out to make it a bit awkward. We will quickly see.
It's a spooky ghost. No, it's just it's just Mana Wraith. Mana Wraith is one of those cards which doesn't see a ton of use, but when it comes out of a Shredder, it can actually be kind of intimidating.
And
well, relevant.
It's kind of annoying because, well, you can trade in the Mana Wraith in order to play Keeper of Old Demand on the 1-1 and play a secret. But look at this hand. Double Redemption? I don't even know people play Double Redemption.
I really wanted to just give Mana Wraith the moment in the sun to you. Like, ah, it's irrelevant. He's doing the first. I'm like, please?
Ah, Frostwolf Grunt may as well be.
Right. So, as you pointed out, options here for Admirable to get rid of that Giant 8-4. And I like Nossum's line of play here. He's just like, I'm just going to start doing the damage. CZ doesn't have patrons. And as you pointed out, you know, you have to get to the patrons. We're also in a really bad spot as the patron player. So he just kind of realizes he needs to start forcing that damage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely going to be rough here because, as you said, the Mana Wraith, you know, the very important drop on the board now, is definitely having an impact. He can trade it away, but even after the trade and being able to play this Keeper of Alderman, it still doesn't feel too great.
Look,
there's no like major impact on the board. That's the real problem here.
I want to say I don't like this line. He could have Keeper of Alderman the 1-1, still traded in both creatures, and had one mana left over to play one of these secrets.
I like this line, though, because Mana Wraith made a minion cost 5, and then he couldn't play a secret.
It seemed like he was shaken up a little bit too much by the Mana Wraith. There was a play where he could have just had one extra mana by doing the exact same thing that he did, even by spending 5. So,
ghosts are spooky. What can you do?
Yeah. Maybe he didn't care about the extra one mana, in which case it's irrelevant, just like a Mana Wraith.
Wow! TJ, please. Please.
But, oh, the Mana Wraith's done nothing to you. It just came out of the shred. It wasn't his choice.
No, it was. He chose to drive the Shredder. Jeez, does nobody get it?
He didn't know it would blow up,
I was going to say, how do ghosts even get driver's license?
Shredders don't just come out of nowhere.
Well, they come out of your deck, but maybe we're getting a little bit off topic.
Okay, yeah. Oh, a little?
See, Nossum plays down that Acolyte of Pain. He's going to get the card draw. Gets a little bit of extra armor. Unfortunately, the Armorsmith has to be sacrificed in the process, but wow. Sludge, Belcher, and Redemption. If there was ever a more annoying combination of Redemption, I'm not sure what it is. Maybe Piloted Shredder. Wow, that was really good, too. That was well played.
Mana Wraith?
No! TJ, why do you say these things?
Well, he's going to hope that he picks up a weapon here, I suppose.
And also hope that's not Redemption. He's going to hope that's just something civil like Noble Sacrifice.
Yeah.
Or Avenge.
At least he gets a good trade with the Acolyte, right? He gets some good cycle. Kills off one Belcher to create another. But he does have Whirlwind as well if he really just wants to start clearing off the three attack more than anything. But yeah, anything gets too punished by that regardless. So probably want to hold on to that Whirlwind to generate some patrons if he ever draws them.
Yeah, setting up this Unstable Ghoul is really great too. Hiding the Armorsmith behind it, yeah, it's cool to get some armor. But what he's doing is he's also setting up to make sure that he can clear off both slimes going into next turn. Because we'll get one Whirlwind effect this turn, and he knows that the slime will be damaged. Because, of course, Sludge Belcher plays first.
Yeah.
The damage goes on to both slimes. He'll be able to use a Whirlwind, if he so chooses, to clear it off. And this will actually be a super clean clear with just a Whirlwind and an Execute used.
Yeah, this is going to be a really nice clear for Nostum. And you
can drop Frothing Berserker as well. So like,
that's bold.
What?
Boombots.
No, you make that risk. I think that's fine. You have Armorsmith to soak up that damage. It's all right.
Nossum disagrees with your rather reckless line of play there, it looks like. Yeah. And I'm inclined to agree with him. I don't think you just YOLO out the Frothing Berserker there. Maybe late night on ladder, you know, after you had a few mugs of ale. Not necessarily the play you want to go for here, I don't think. True Silver Champion makes all the sense in the world. Just get rid of that Frothing Berserker before it does a lot of damage to you.
Pull up a hair by the charm.
What? Yeah, I have time to just yellow out my Frothing Berserker.
That's what ale does to you.
Well.
I've silenced Rob's success.
I was going to say, Twitch chat's very appreciative of your efforts there. One way, though, I want to point out that the patron player can win this, aside from drawing patrons, because obviously he's yet to draw any whatsoever.
Yeah.
Is just drawing a bunch of cards in Battle Rage. Is that still something this deck has in common from the deck of 2015, which is draw a bunch of cards? And we see here the Secret Paladin player, Admirable, not necessarily having a lot of cards, and he's still got Mysterious Challenger, although it's kind of a diminishing return on him.
Yeah, and also, this is where we see the real benefit of Korkron Elite as well. It's just going to help push for that extra damage. You can Korkron Fiery War Axe, and then the turn after play Grom Whirlwind. So it's just going to help pressure just that little bit more, and maybe help him now push through this this Mysterious Challenger that's now taunting Divine Shield. So probably going to see the Slam get played. It has the double benefit of removing the Divine Shield and drawing a card.
Second Execute. Now, we're at the point where, if you're Nostum, the only other threats you're really expecting are Tyrion Forgering. Occasionally you see Ragnaros in this deck now, but you know you might think it's okay to just kind of execute here. Although here we go, it's time for the Secret Procession.
Yeah, there's still an Avenge up, I believe, so the Avenge will go on to the Mysterious Challenger here. So he might have to use the Execute
in order
to
clear this off. Might have to use the Whirlwind too,
right? Yeah, well I think if you're going to use the Whirlwind, you'd probably want to hit face. So Execute definitely is going to be the play. And he knows that one of the cards in the hand, if he has deductive reasoning, it's probably a secret. Because he only pulled three secrets from that, and he didn't see Competitive Spirit. So, and he saw it in one of the other games. So he knows that it's there.
Yeah, and also like you said earlier about one of the real big threats left is Tyrion. He will have known that redemption or that that card would have been in his hand for a long time. So you think, oh, okay, it's one of his late drops. But then he's like not played it yet. So it's like, okay, this is definitely not Tyrion because there's no reason why you wouldn't drop that on curve.
Well, that's game because there's no more noble sacrifices. Admirable tries to make the bluff.
Unfortunately, Admirable was going to go ahead and concede, and Nostum completes the reverse sweep, bringing it back from 0-2 to win 3-2. And for Nostum, must feel great to get the dizzying lows and the dizzying highs of going from one match away from lower bracket to just winning, and now you've got your spot in tomorrow's match where you could potentially just go to the America's Winter Championship.
Yeah, from his humble roots as a wacky young lad from upstate New York or Long Island, wherever he's from.
I was gonna say, I feel like
two very different places.
I feel like if you asked him to describe himself, TJ, that's not how he would have gone.
I think I was not
a wacky young lad, but for Admirable, he still got a chance to do this. Obviously, going down to the lower bracket now with some of the other players we've been talking about over the course of the afternoon, but played very well for the most part. You know, Secret Paladin loses three times. Mm-hmm. It happens. We saw this last year a lot with Druid.
Yeah, I think actually you see that the style in lineup there where it really did. If you looked at Nostum's decks, it was like, I will not lose to Secret Paladin. And it actually worked out that way because each deck he played against it performed really well. And although the games were close and they both played really well, like, you know, it's really difficult to be a lineup that just stomps a deck so hard.
Yeah, I really like seeing that Pyroblast and Freeze Mage. That's kind of one of those cards that isn't always in the deck. Sometimes people favor the more defensive build, which is like Double Healbot, because it does help in matchups.
Or Malygos.
Right. Well, now that's a Fibonacci special, I feel like. I feel like you don't necessarily see that too much, but Pyroblast, usually something that's seen more as being kind of control matchup centric, but the Double Healbot is gone for more aggressive lineups. But it did pay dividends against the Secret Paladin because, as you pointed out, you realize this is how I'm going to win the game. I'm not going to go super late. I'm just going to Pyroblast him in the face on turn 10.
Yeah, some players that play Freeze Mage that are a little more inexperienced think that Freeze Mage win conditions are very linear, that you stall the game out until you get Alexstrasza. You drop Alexstrasza, get him to 15, and then you burn him down. But in reality, a lot of times, you have so much burn in your deck that a deck with not many heals, only True Silver Champion, like Secret Paladin has, you can just start counting your damage and realize that that's the win condition that you have to go for. So really smart by Nostum. I liked his deck choices, so I'm really impressed. Looking forward to seeing more of him.
Right, and Admirable, we will be seeing more of tomorrow, it looks like. Hopefully we'll get the chance to cast more of his matches. Obviously we joked around a lot. Admirable has a very larger-than-life personality, but as a friend of mine, very cool guy to hang out with. As you said, very, very intense and very fun to be around, so hoping he can close us out and make it to top 8.
Yeah, and so Admirable's a guy who, when he has a conversation with you, you see this look in his eyes. He'll come at you and he'll go, hey, did you hear about? And then your whole body just slows down. Your world just becomes slow. And you look at this intense look in your eyes and you go, Admirable, hold on. Give me a second. Let me sit down. Let me grab a cup of water. He's one of the most fun people to talk to just because you know that every single conversation is going to be intense like that. And it's really interesting. He's a unique guy.
Right, so we've given our thoughts on the match now, but we want to hear from Dan, who's standing by in the host area, obviously being extremely well-dressed.
Thank you very much, Rob. No disagreements here, both on your analysis of the game as well as my fashion sense. That is our second to last match of the day in the books. Nostum takes it over Admirable. You know, I was pulling for Admirable a little bit as a fellow caster, but you know what? He has another shot in the lower bracket. Nostum joins a small group of individuals who will be guaranteed at least $2,500 for their placements in the top 16 so far, but they still have to win one more to guarantee top 8. We have a couple of other names that will be joining them. Fibonacci actually has won all the way through and is also joining Nostum, as well as a new dark horse named WTY Bill, who defeated Lemiju in order to get to that spot. So we do have some couple players that are also established and a couple players who are unestablished going into it. Also, we do have an upset. I believe Amnesiac did get to that round just the same as Admirable and Nostum, but was unfortunately defeated. And I do not have the player name in front of me right now, but I'll go ahead and update you guys next time on the commercial break. I just heard that there was an upset, so I was like, oh no, I have to report that. But then they called me up here. Coming up next, we have our last match of the day. So make sure to go ahead and get your last tweets in before the broadcast closes by hashtagging HCT and tweeting us at PlayHearthstone or go to Facebook.com/Hearthstone. I'm Frodan, and when we come back, more updates and more Hearthstone to close out day number one here of the Winter Prelims of the America's Championship. Stay tuned.